Thank you, Mr. Lawrence, for this interview. First of all, the foreign minister of Germany, Frank-Walter Steinmeier, said on 8th of October that the current situation between USA and Russia is even more dangerous than the Cold War. In Syria, we see a horrible war in Ukraine, a protected war with deadly episodes. How big is the risk to have a deadly military confrontation USA, Russia in Syria and respectively in Europe?
I think that it is not about a confrontation in Syria, but I agree that the situation in some respects is more dangerous than during the Cold War, and Russia tries to exploit the regional superiority over NATO. It tries to exploit this trust that actually West put on Russia after the Cold War, hoping that it will change into the direction of the stable and predictable country. And we can see that Russia has some strategic goals that it wants to achieve by intimidating NATO and possibly by also exploiting this regional superiority. But it has, first of all, it has this regional superiority along NATO and EU borders, and this is what we should be really afraid of. If we know that their strategic goal is to reintegrate the post-Soviet space, but also to maintain a buffer zone on the territory of the new NATO and EU member states and former members of Warsaw Pact, it leads us to the conclusion that they can try in the black case scenario. Of course, it's not the most likely, but still it cannot be excluded, that they will try to use military force to create the situation where NATO, US will not be able to find a military solution, and they will be forced to negotiate with Russia on the new security architecture in Europe. And then Russia can exploit this not through its presence in Syria, but through its regional superiority in the Baltic Sea region and after the annexation of Crimea, also in the Black Sea region.
So let's take a few recent issues. Russia has deployed to Kaliningrad the nuclear capable Iskander missiles just between Poland and Lithuania. How is this move seen from Poland?
It is exactly seen according to this narrative that I mentioned. We can see for at least 10 years that signals coming out from Russia are, we have the nuclear balance with the US. We are able to escalate tensions up to the nuclear weapons at the up to the nuclear strategic level. At the same time, the West to a large extent removed nuclear weapons from Western Europe. Russia has regional conventional superiority over NATO. Of course, in the media you will see some numbers that NATO has 2.5 million of troops and Russia only 800,000 or something. But in the regional, you can see that Russia is able to mobilize 80,000 or 100,000 troops within 3 days, and NATO would be able to deploy 50,000 troops within 1 month and a half to the region. The consequence of this is that Russia can play the game of coercive diplomacy, and it tries to show that regional countries, that NATO, they do not have too many options, and Russia is able to decrease our security. It is able to move different sorts of weapons that will threaten not only immediate neighbors, but that they can also threaten old NATO and EU countries, because Iskander missiles deployed to Kaliningrad, according to different estimates, their range can even be enough to reach Berlin. So all those moves are to demonstrate that we don't have too many options apart of negotiating the new deal of the security of Europe. And And the Russian president of that time in 2008, Dmitry Medvedev, came up with the idea of new European security treaty, which boils down to Russia having a right to block NATO enlargement or EU enlargement to the post-Soviet space, but also it would have the right to block any significant NATO deployments to our region, even for defensive purposes. So all in all, this is another move that is sending the signal that Russia has the superiority and NATO does not have too many options to stop Russia from escalating.
Yes, but at the Warsaw meeting of NATO, Warsaw summit, there were all sorts of measures decided there. We don't have any solution to this corrosive diplomacy of Russia?
This is a very good question. Of course, we need to look at the developments from the strategic perspective. NATO for most part of recent two decades demonstrated that it hopes that Russia will not become a threat, that NATO was determined to develop strategic partnership with Russia, that it is not planning anything against Russia, because even if there was enlargement, it was mainly political, not military, because the infrastructure has not followed the political enlargement of NATO. So actually, Russia did not have any reason to treat NATO as a threat. Once Russia broke most of the agreements that were the pillars of this security architecture in Europe, with annexation of Crimea, but even before that, with the aggression against Georgia in 2008, NATO had to adapt to this situation. But the adaptation is usually very slow and also prudent. You don't want to make moves that could be used against you, that could be used for propaganda reasons, that NATO is preparing for war, or that NATO is changing its peaceful posture into aggressive posture. We also had to take under consideration the political and economic reality. So you can make the assessment that the strategic environment, that the security situation completely changed, but it would be very difficult for NATO to make a very big change in its posture. So it had to go step by step, looking how Russia will react. So first thing during the Wales summit in 2014 was to improve the deployability of NATO troops. So there was this agreement that we'll create so-called spearhead, one land brigade that could be deployed pretty quickly, that will strengthen the overall NATO response force, and it was very important. Although we need to remember that the deterrent effect of this is very limited. We improved our ability to react to some hybrid scenarios, but we probably, as a NATO, we were unable to influence Russia's calculations that, okay, we can exploit the divisions, we will create the situation to which NATO will not be able to respond, or it will be afraid of the escalation. Let's imagine this black case scenario, mm-hmm. not the most likely, but still not completely unlikely, that Russia, under the pretext of snap exercises, that it organizes hundreds of them every year, carries out some offensive operation, and within 2 days it takes out 5 square kilometers of Estonia or of Latvia. And then what could NATO do? It would have to reclaim back the lost territory. It would need to take under consideration that Russia has S-300 or S-400 very capable air and missile defense systems in Kaliningrad. So what do? Do we destroy them, risking that Russia will respond with tactical nuclear weapons? We know that Russia, during the exercises, used nuclear weapons against NATO states. We know that they have the doctrine with pretty low threshold of tactical nuclear weapons that can be exploited to scare the opponent and to so-called to de-escalate. So it would be a huge political and military challenge for NATO to reclaim back the lost territory. And this is what Russia is maybe counting on. So this first reaction of NATO during the Wales summit, it was that we improved our ability to react to some hybrid scenarios that we saw in Ukraine, how Crimea was annexed. But usually when you try to get some strategic gain, you also try to have some strategic surprise. So it would be very surprising if Russia used the same modus operandi that it employed in Ukraine against NATO territory. And we saw that after this first move in Wales summit, Russia did not de-escalate, it escalated further. So this is why NATO had to make another decision. It decided to stick to this one-sided political agreement that it will not deploy huge forces into the region, but nevertheless it decided to deploy 4 combat battalions in Baltic states and in Poland. Their combat significance is not very big. Again, Russia could overcome those forces very easily, but they can influence Russian calculations, because this multinational presence in the region, it signifies that if Russia decided to carry out some aggressive operation, it needs to take under consideration that all NATO will be involved, that it will not be able to divide the alliance, that multinational forces will be involved, will be affected, and the probability that Article 5 will be employed, the collective defense mechanisms will trigger, and that Russia is in war with 28 and future in not so distant future with 29 member states.
Yes, but as it seems, those spearheads and those battalions decided they are not huge capabilities of deployment of NATO. So furthermore, which would be the proper solution?
I think that looking at we cannot take things out of political and economic context. If we know what are the political realities, that it takes months and years for different countries to understand that Russia can be a threat, that actually it has some aggressive agenda, and it wants to reclaim back the post-Soviet space to make up for those strategic losses that it suffered when the Soviet Union collapsed and Warsaw Pact was dismantled. It really takes time for the societies in the West, in the United States, to understand that this is not the actor that if you say, okay, take the Crimea, let's forget it and let's come back to good relations again. It will not solve the problem, but we know this in this region, but sometimes people in more distant countries that are not directly threatened, they don't understand this, and it usually takes time to pass this message for those societies and to pass this message for the political elites which make decisions as well. So whether we could do more, I think that with this reality that we have, it was pretty sensible decision to do things step by step. We also need time to rebuild the capabilities that NATO lost after the Cold War, the capabilities to have the credible territorial defense. This is very expensive, and it will take years and years to invest in tanks, in submarines, in high-end warfare capabilities This is immensely expensive, and we only see that it was only in 2015 that the cuts in the defense spending in NATO was stopped. But this will be not enough, and we will need to increase the spending. We will need the planning is already there, but it will really take years to rebuild this credible territorial defense.
But all in all the NATO members have much bigger defense spending than Russia has.
Definitely it has. But again, this is not that simple, because NATO is the alliance of sovereign states, and they give only a part of its capability for NATO needs. So again, we come back to this idea that you can see in the media the arguments, as I said, that overall NATO capabilities are much bigger. But when you know that in the Western military district there are 400,000 troops, and Russia invested in its force posture is of offensive character, that it opened or created new bases close to NATO borders, that it maintains its troops in high readiness mode, so it is able to carry out a surprise operation. And then when you look at the operational troops, what NATO has in this space of operational troops, this is not 2 million. Okay. This is around 70,000 or something, of which only 45,000 could be deployed within 1 month and a half. And this is the major difference, that this is the major difference between the Cold War and the new strategic reality. And during the Cold War, you had 400,000 or 500,000 American troops in Western Germany. And this was the credible territorial defense. There were British troops, French troops on German territory. There were all sorts of tactical nuclear weapons. These days, NATO has completely different defensive strategy. It is so-called in-depth defense. Mm-hmm. So strategically, yes, we are stronger. But regionally, Russia is much stronger, and it can miscalculate that it could be able to exploit this regional superiority, and that NATO will not react, that this regional conflict would not be turned into a larger scale war with NATO. And this is what we should be afraid of this miscalculation, that Russia can exploit regional superiority. Whether we have the answer for this, there is risk, but I can't see any other option. We have to strengthen our defenses, we have to strengthen the credibility of Article 5. There needs to be different strategic signals that the US is committed, that France is committed, or Germany and Great Britain, all those big countries that have some capabilities. Two of them, Britain and France, they also have their national nuclear potential. So all those messages and signals are also very, very important. And this is what we are doing now.
You said that a lot of societies, maybe in the western part of Europe, they are not aware of the Russian threats, for example, in the East. And they are reluctant to spending more and more in defense against Russia. But on the other hand, we see in Syria and in northern Iraq that France, Britain, and the USA, they work hand in hand, shoulder to shoulder, and in the UN Security Council they do that as well against Russian positions and the Assad regime. So in the Middle East we have a quite strong NATO partners alliance.
This is very important aspect that you touched, that Russia obviously exploited the power vacuum in Syria. It moved to Syria militarily, first of all, to defend Assad's regime, because it defends its own interest in Syria. It showed that it will not let the regime fall. But at the same time, It acted strategically in this bigger game of creating the new security architecture in Europe by coming into Syria and by blocking US and some other allies' room of maneuver. Russia demonstrated for propaganda reasons that it wants to create the anti-terrorist coalition with the US and Western countries. And the major message was, let's fight together with terrorists, although they completely differently interpret who is a terrorist, because they think that everybody who fights Assad regime is a terrorist. But nevertheless, let's create this anti-terrorist coalition and forget about some other issues that are really minor. And this could be the message that some part of the Western societies could buy, because the terrorist threat is the major threat for them. They are not afraid of Russian rockets or even of the negative consequences of changed security architecture, because it would not affect directly France or Italy. But terrorist threat is something that they can see almost on daily basis. This is something they are afraid of. So they think, why shouldn't we cooperate with Russia? Let's cooperate with them. Mm-hmm. But the Russian idea was that it will create a very good positive momentum, that they will demonstrate to the world that it's better to cooperate with Russia, that we have common interests, and then it will be easier to forget about Ukraine, Crimea, and nobody will pay attention what Russia is doing close to the Baltic states in the Baltic Sea or Black Sea region. Western countries, like leaders of France or the US, I think that they could see this game from the very beginning, that Russia was not really focused on fighting ISIS, even if it increased attacks against ISIS. But the main rationale was to defend Assad's regime and to create the humanitarian crisis at the same time, to increase pressure on the West, to increase the wave of the refugees. The refugees will come to Europe, to increase the risk of terrorism to Europe. And then this is, as always, if you play this kind of game, you try to increase costs for your adversary. At the same time, you offer some solution. And now this is exactly where we are. They are creating this humanitarian crisis in Aleppo. They are targeting civilians specifically. The West cannot do much, because if it wanted to stop Russia, it would risk the escalation of the conflict. The escalation could move easily to the Baltic Sea or to the Black Sea, where Russia has this regional superiority. So the West can, for the time being, the only thing it can do is to exert political pressure on Russia. And this is what France and US, by accusing Russia of this manslaughter, this is what they are doing.
Political and economical, because
and economic sanctions as well. Sanctions are also important, although we need to remember that Russia is rather more immune to sanctions than some other countries, right? Democratic countries can be easily become less stable because people will be unhappy. Russia, for the Russian authorities for the last decade, tried to insulate the society from outside influence. It can easily use the propaganda. It can limit the access of the society to some outside information. So people can be rather and we can see this in public opinion polls, that they support Putin, they are happy that Russia regains the status, and some economic problems are of secondary nature. So the sanctions are very important, that EU was able to impose sanctions, because it was not to, you know, make Russia crumble, because nobody wants this and it will not lead to this scenario, but it was another strategic signal that Russia cannot calculate, that it will divide the West, that that even on the EU level, which is usually much more divided than NATO, that it needs to calculate that that the West will be unified if it exploits this military power.
But nevertheless, at the level of the common people in the Western European countries, at the level of the society, there is the debate is focused on the terrorism, on the Middle East issues, on ISIS, on migrants from the Middle East, and this is why maybe the Western societies are closer to Russia than in this regard. For example, we've seen in the Netherlands that referendum with basically no legal abiding. The common people in Netherlands actually made a very clear attitude against the Ukrainian people and the Ukrainian society.
And I would say that this is pretty natural, because even from the perspective of the countries of this region, who which have pretty negative experiences of Russia's imperial politics, it's obvious that it would be better to have good relations with Russia, and this is what we want. Actually, we want to we want Russia to become a predictable partner, and we want to live peacefully. Nobody believes that you know, it is a credible option to come back to the Cold War, like, you know, force postures and Russia's containment. Mm. But this is not that we chose this pathway. This is Russia which chose the pathway of confrontation and escalation. But of course, in the West, and exactly like in during the Cold War, where the threat was much bigger, there are a lot of people who believe that, you know, that at that time the Soviet Union, they believe that it is not a threat. They rather wanted to convince the world that it is capitalism which is much worse than communism. These days we also have, you know, the very deep anti-American sentiment. Unfortunately, war in Iraq did not help, you know, to strengthen American image in Europe or in many other parts of the world. So there are a lot of people who just do not know what are the strategic, what is at stake, they believe that, okay, maybe Russia has its some interests. Let's forget about Ukraine, but U.S. and the West and this liberal democracy is also not too good. So and Russia exploits it for propaganda reasons, purposes very very skillfully. But as I said, this kind of reality, we will have to deal with this always. The numbers of people who will understand what is going on will change slightly, but not to this extent that the politicians will be able to have a mandate to do some big things, like, you know, spend 3 or 4% on defense. Nevertheless, the very important thing, as always, is that you have political elites that have strategic vision and that they know what is at stake. And this is how democracy works, that sometimes political elites need to take difficult decisions, even if societies do not understand them.
Poland and Romania, both countries are key pillars of the US anti-missile system development in Europe and NATO's comprehensive anti-missile architecture. How close are Poland and Romania, one to each other and to the US, in terms of interest and loyalty?
In terms of interests, they are very close, and loyalty is the function of interests, I would say, because this is how international relations work. I would say that the United States, after the Cold War, has strategic interests in this region, and they definitely are not interested in maybe a part of some politicians in the United States, but when you look at this interest of the whole country, this is definitely that it is in their interest not to put this region again in some gray zone between the West and the old West, let's say, in these terms, and Russia. And it translates into US policies towards Romania and Poland. The placing of missile defense, which is very important to remember that this is not against Russia, but this is only the element that will defend part of Europe from the attack, against the attack coming from Middle East, probably from Iran, because Iran is developing a ballistic missile program, even if it made this agreement on nuclear weapons. So this is the placing of some elements of strategic importance for the United States on territory of Romania and territory of Poland. From our perspective, it increases the in strategic importance of the region for the United States, and it may translate into the commitment of security guarantees. For Russia, obviously, this is not about, you know, changing the balance or being able to attack, you know, Russian territory from the base in Poland or from the base in Romania. This is about increasing the importance of this region in American calculations, and this is what Russia is furious about.
But anyway, this anti-ballistic shield has no effect regarding Russia.
No, absolutely no. And this is one of those policies in NATO. Of course, you know, there are politicians in Poland that would like to see NATO change this policy, but there is no agreement on this. NATO decided that it will not develop the missile defense that it will protect, you know, the territory of the alliance from the attack from Russia, and this is one of those also strategic vulnerabilities that together with this regional Russian superiority, which is written in this 1997 NATO-Russia Founding Act, this is one of those strategic vulnerabilities that we show that, okay, we still feel pretty confident that Russia will de-escalate, that it will come back to normal, and that it will not exploit this regional superiority. But in future, if it becomes more and more aggressive, and if it does something against NATO territory, I wouldn't exclude that NATO will go away from those commitments, and it will be something that will affect the Russian security.
In what
way? In which sense? Yes. In this sense that that Russia will not be security from the Russian perspective, in this sense that Russia will not have this regional superiority. Of course, defensive systems increase the likelihood that you would have the political commitment and political will to deploy troops to the region. From Russian perspective, although it wouldn't change the, it wouldn't change the NATO posture into offensive posture, but by increasing the likelihood of carrying out the defensive operation here in this region, Russia should calculate that, you know, bigger forces and in shorter time could be able to be deployed to this region.
Historically, in our defense complex, the Baltic Sea, Black Sea Isthmus has been a strategic pillar. Today, in this is this position still very important, the Baltic Sea, Black Sea Isthmus?
It is very important in this sense that all along from high north down to the eastern Mediterranean, Russia has this ability to exploit superiority and to set up anti-access area denial, those A2AD capabilities, which would block NATO room of maneuver. It would make difficult even defensive operation if Russia decided to become aggressive there. And of course, it is very important that the whole region cooperates, in that we strengthen our defenses in equally, because what sense does it make that we will have, you know, a very strong Baltic Baltic Sea region, and we will feel confident when Russia will be able to exploit and to get strategic consequences, superiority by exploiting the weakness in the Black Sea. So from the Polish perspective, it is very important that we cooperate with Romania. And we look at Romania, I think that all the governments, consecutive governments, look at Romania as the partner with the biggest potential in the region. When you, again, Poland is only like sixth biggest country in EU, but regionally, our defense budget, which again, comparing to France or Great Britain, is not that big. It's around $9 billion this year. But it is bigger than all the 11 countries that joined NATO after 1999 taken together. So it shows that, you know, the potential of this region is not that big. But again, Romania is the biggest, the most important country in this region. And this line of defense definitely needs to be strengthened, especially through the cooperation between Poland and Romania.
Because you brought about the investment in the defense of Poland. Poland seems to invest more than Romania in the armed forces. For example, Poland already has 48 F-16 jets, fighter jets. Romania commissioned 12 and received 6 so far. In the Navy, Poland has submarines, it has 2 frigates. Romania has 3 frigates and 1 broker submarine, for example. So is Romania a reliable ally for Poland in the Isthmus?
Definitely it is a reliable ally. We have financial reality, and we have the reality of the countries that only 25 years ago regained sovereignty and that had to invest in many, many things, taking care of its security at the same time. But we know what was the starting point for us, how long way we still have to go to keep up with Western Europe, to have a decent level of living. So these are very difficult choices, and you know, if we invest in our military at the cost of what? Of our social security, of the development. One thing that is very important and we should remember is that investments in the military, they can also stimulate the economy. And this is what Poland tries to do. That we also need to invest in defenses in this prudent, intelligent way. That we try to cooperate together to cut costs, right? To get the economy of scale. If we have F-16s and Romania will have F-16s, there is the room for cooperation of cutting down costs on some training exercises, different things. And this is where we need to take more from our defenses. But I would say that we definitely look at Romania as a reliable partner, understanding you know, financial constraints, sometimes political constraints, yeah, which are maybe not the major issue in Romania, but in some other countries in the region they are. You just need to think what is feasible, what you can achieve. You just don't get frustrated, you don't get emotional, you think rationally what can be achieved, and you try to achieve it as soon as possible.
In September, Poland announced to seek $5 billion deals on Patriot missiles. What is the strategic purpose here?
Because we mentioned that NATO is not developing air and missile defense that would protect NATO territory from the attack from Russia. So actually, if you want to have any cover, you need to do it on the national basis or in cooperation with partners on bilateral level. And because we are this region that actually is within the range of different missiles, Iskander missiles, which are very capable and very dangerous, but also some cruise type missiles that can be launched from different directions. If you want to be able to defend your strategic assets, your leadership, harbors that are very important for reinforcements, airfields which you need to defend if you want your F-16s to be able to defend territory. So you need to develop air and missile defense on your own. It is very, very expensive. It would be, of course, better if we cooperated regionally and we would be able to have more batteries. But usually it is beyond the reach of countries with smaller budgets.
As Russia has Kaliningrad here near near Poland and Lithuania, Russia also has now the Crimea Peninsula, which is very close to Romania, and makes Russia capable to deploy cruise missiles there and to reach Romanian shores as well.
Yeah, this is very, very, very good point. And this is why we need to invest, even if Poland invests in those capabilities. It is very important from the perspective of the whole NATO, because we know that we have too few of those systems. Nobody, maybe in Poland and in our region, there were some estimates that the situation can deteriorate very quickly. But in the West, nobody believed that it can, you know, the situation can change so quickly, and we will need more Patriot batteries or some other systems of some other companies. Nevertheless, we need more of them, and the countries that have budgets should buy them. Those systems are deployable, and then this is also very important, and we demonstrated in this in Turkey, that if an ally feels threatened, we can deploy those systems to different regions, right? So if Poland invests in national capabilities, they can also be used for NATO operations or NATO defense missions in other regions. Also in the spirit of collective defense. But definitely we will need to make those investments, and this is not only about Poland. Also the same decisions will have to be taken in many other countries.
In Romania too, do you think we should acquire such
I think
system?
that Romania will need to prioritize, and this is what Romania is doing. You have very good assessment how drastically the security situation in the Black Sea region has changed. You mentioned those capabilities that Russia deployed or can deploy to Crimea, that Romania is within the reach of different systems, that actually we need more aircraft there. This is the first thing, and you are trying to fill this gap. But we will also need some modern system like anti-ship missiles, air and missile defense systems of different ranges. You will just need to calculate what you can afford, whether there is a chance for regional cooperation, and you will have to invest gradually to fill all those gaps that they are.
Yes, but in the regard of the failed coup in Turkey and the Bulgaria's refusal to join a possible NATO flotilla in the Black Sea, it seems that Romania remained there in the Black Sea quite alone to manage the security situation there out there. So in the terms of the Montreux Convention as well. So how does Poland see the situation? Is Romania still a reliable ally as a key point of the Black Sea, Baltic Sea isthmus?
Well, it only shows that the meaning of Romania is even more important. You mentioned Turkey.
Yeah.
Of course, Turkey was also a difficult ally during the Cold War. These days, I wouldn't exaggerate with the strategic cooperation between Turkey and Russia. Of course, Turkey has its interests in Syria first of all, and it's absolutely primary interest is not to let any Kurdish state to appear close to the borders, and this is what they are focused on. And to avoid this, they are even ready to have even better cooperation and then try to mend fences after this downing of Russian aircraft last year. But historically and strategically, a part of energy or economy, Turkey and Russia do not have common interests. And this is one thing that we need to remember, that Turkey also needs to rely on nuclear umbrella of the US and Article 5 security guarantees that provide this this umbrella over Turkey. So as long as Turkey is not a nuclear power, it definitely does not have the interest in undermining the credibility of NATO or getting out of NATO. But regarding to Bulgaria, again, this is the country that is very dependent on Russia, and it needs to maneuver. We also need to look at this from political perspective. I'm sure that Bulgarian authorities, or majority of them, because there are some politicians that obviously don't see any problem with Russia's behavior, but majority of them understand that this is the question of the status of the whole region, of the status of Romania, future status of Bulgaria. If we are in the gray zone of security, it will affect our civilizational development for decades, if not half century or even more. So they are well aware of this. At the same time, they need to pay some penalties for canceling the nuclear power plant contract with Russia. They are dependent on Russian energy, so they need to demonstrate that okay, we will block some things. Mm-hmm. Whether it has a strategically negative effect for Black Sea region, I would look for different solutions. I would look for the solution. Okay, if we have some gap, and Russia can carry out the offensive operation, for example, by the flotilla, let's buy anti-ship missiles, and it will change the situation for the benefit of Romania or other littoral states.
So do you think shore capabilities would be a solution?
I think it would help. This is what Poland actually tried to do. That we also have, after many years of underfunding of our navy, mainly navy, we have some gaps there, and we just deployed anti-ship missiles along our coasts. These are pretty capable missiles, and any adversary will have to take those capabilities under account.
Mm-hmm. Yes, but regarding Turkey, we've seen President Erdogan and President Putin at the same table. They signed the deal regarding Turkstream in the energy sector, and they have a very similar doctrinary speech and discourse.
This is, I don't say that, you know, this is not something that we are not following. We should follow this. And it used to be a strategic, you know, question even before Russia annexed Crimea, where Turkey, you know, Turkey's politics is going, whether still Turkey has more common interests with the West and with NATO, EU, or it wants to be an independent strategic regional player that will run its own policy. We could see it in some plans of procurements, military procurements, their air and missile defense systems that they planned to procure from China. These were we had those questions, and obviously we know that close economic cooperation, it can also translate for some political decision making during the time of crisis. But this is, of course, in Turkey now it's on a big scale, but we cannot forget that many other European countries, that they have very close and strong economic relations with Russia, that Germany still wants to develop Nord Stream 2, the pipeline that goes from Russia to Germany in the Baltic Sea. That there are very, very strong economic interests, and some politicians need to balance. On one hand, that they need to, you know, to take under consideration that the economy is very, very important, that we also don't want Russia to crumble totally. Yes. And we don't want to show that we are cutting off building any new Berlin Wall or any kind of wall, that we hope that we will be able to cooperate in the future. negative consequence of this, and we unfortunately we need to live with this, is that it can translate into the political will if there is a crisis. But we won't solve this.
To sum up and to get back to Steinmeier's assessment and to sum up our discussion or interview, what consequences would face we would face in a potential U.S.-Russia clash, Poland, Romania, NATO, etc. So, are there any serious risks?
Of course.
Towards a Russia-U.S. Conflict in Europe, and what consequences we would face?
Of course, there are. And again, we have to remember that strategic situation has completely changed. And it's during the Cold War, American commitment toward Europe came from the fact that, you know, any attack against Western Germany or Western Europe, it would mean that, you know, this, there is this communist ideology of having a world revolution. So it would be only the first step towards the confrontation with the US. So Americans knew that they need to deter the Soviet Union and the Warsaw Pact here in Europe, and it translated into bigger commitment. These days we know that Russia has some regional political aims. It would like to change the security architecture, but it is not going to wage war against the United States, because it's much, much weaker. And even if it you know, has the deterrence, the strategic nuclear deterrence, it definitely would not like this kind of confrontation. But this, unfortunately, can translate into this miscalculation that Russia exploits regional superiority, carries out some aggressive operation against NATO. It turns into not a limited conflict that Russia hoped that it would be able to control and enforce the negotiations. It escalates into a bigger conflict. What it means for our region, unfortunately, mainly for the Baltic states, Poland and Romania, the countries that are within the range of Russian systems, it would mean that those parts of NATO territory and EU territory would be involved in the conflict. So we would bear the biggest costs of this. What would it mean for the US? The US would definitely win any conflict with Russia. And as Zbigniew Brzeziński, just after the Cold War, when USSR collapsed, when he talked to one of the generals, they talked, you know, how conflicts would could develop if there was finally a clash. Brzeziński said, "General, within 30 minutes of any conflict, you and your comrades would be dead." So this is actually, it showed even at that time the American, probably American superiority in precision strike capability, in, you know, how they planned how to decapitate Russia, how to remove the leadership. I'm sure that the Russian elites are pretty well aware of the difference of potentials between Russia and the US, and they wouldn't like to move this conflict to the strategic level, but unfortunately they can miscalculate and they can try to exploit this regional superiority. And this is why we need to increase the credibility of the deterrence, the credibility of our defenses, because this is the best way to deter Russia, to demonstrate that they will not achieve those aims, what they planned to probably planned to achieve. This is why we need to stay calm, to not to overreact, to understand what are our weaknesses, that we need time to invest in them, but we need to invest in them, that we need to take the most of the regional cooperation, etc., etc. This is there are a lot of areas where we need to strengthen our defenses, starting even from the resilience, so Russia will not be able to carry out any hybrid scenario. But it is very important that countries like Poland and Romania know what to do and that we do what is necessary.
Thank you, Mr. Lawrence.
Thank you very much.